Well, with us now for more on her assessment post-ASEAN summit is Ambassador Marilyn Alarilla, whose previous postings include Laos and Turkey. She is senior lecturer and consultant at the De La Salle College of St. Benilde. Good to have you with us, Ambassador. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Kathy. Good morning.
So how do you think the Philippine government did in communicating its causes to its ASEAN neighbors in Laos?
Well, we can just congratulate the Philippine team led by our president, President Duterte, and Foreign Minister, Perfecto Yasay, for taking this opportunity of this summit in Laos, Vientiane, to present our perspective on the Philippine priorities at the moment.
Well, Yasay gave President Duterte an 8.5 at the ASEAN. Do you agree in spite of the gaffes?
Well, maybe I'm not ready to give the rating now.
Okay, well, what strides has the Philippines made in the way of say, building on the Hague win, granting the Philippines its maritime rights over disputed waters off the West Philippine Sea? Because, as we know, the ASEAN leaders ended up playing down tensions in a carefully worded statement.
Well, ASEAN is a process. So, we started 1967, 50 years ago, and then we'll be chairing ASEAN next year. So with respect to the Hague ruling, this will undergo the process in the, we have ASEAN Maritime Cooperation, and certainly that will be considered. We also have the ASEAN-China Declaration on Code of Conduct, and that has been going on for some time. And now we are pressing for a code of conduct that will be agreed upon between ASEAN and China, which will be more on a legal basis.
So would you say on balance that there had been incremental improvements in getting towards that goal of establishing a code of conduct with China?
Yes, you're right, because ASEAN, you know, we have cultural considerations, and we consider the views and sentiments of our partner nations as well as ASEAN member countries.
You know, at the closing of the ASEAN summit, the president underscored the importance of human rights, recounting the atrocities against ethnic people in Mindanao. How has this come across, you think, to the international community at a time Duterte is being rebuked for his war on drugs that have led to over 3,000 deaths linked to alleged extrajudicial killings?
In ASEAN, the Philippines, together with Indonesia, leads the issue on human rights. We were at the forefront of fighting for recognition of human rights in ASEAN. We started with the human rights of women and children. So through our initiative and our follow-up, ASEAN finally had a statement on human rights, and this was on women and children. And also, we are in partnership with civil society organizations all throughout 10 ASEAN member countries. So we were able to have an ASEAN Committee on Human Rights. So for us, we consider human rights as a priority, and then there is no problem with raising the issue of human rights because we are traditionally championing human rights.
But what about on the war on drugs? I mean, the last time we talked, you expressed concern about the manner in which the war on drugs is being executed here. What now with
well,
the number of killings going
on? In international relations, we have two theories, deontological, which means you are after your goals, you do the correct thing, the right thing. And the other theory is consequentialism, which means the end justifies the means. Now, the leaning in international law is you have to do it correctly. So it's not what you anticipate as the result, but how you do it matters. So, but I think our government also recognized that because we are also conscious about how we handle extrajudicial killing and how our military handles the drive against drugs.
Now, looking back now and with all the dust fairly settled, what, if any, has the canceled meeting between Duterte and President Obama cost the Philippines?
Well, this is just temporary noise. This will not really dampen the strong Philippine-U.S. relations. There are other bases on relationship between the Philippines and the United States. we have many common values, common advocacies. So we will look at the foundation of our relations between the Philippines and United States.
Okay, and finally, what should the Philippines do now between now and next year's summit as we head into the 50th anniversary of the ASEAN, where we're chairing that?
Well, Philippines is in a very good position to advance the integration of ASEAN and to improve the initiatives and contribute to advancement and fostering of all the plans of ASEAN. We have been a major contributor in the past 50 years, and we look forward to the future, looking at trends in globalization, comprehensive security, and we have good relations with all countries, so we will be definitely be able to have a successful and meaningful chairmanship in 2017.
Okay, well, thank you so much for your views and your time. Ambassador Alarilla joining us on the line there, senior lecturer at the De La Salle College of St. Benilde.